Good day, this is Jim Pytel from Columbia Gorge Community College. This is Digital Electronics. This lecture is entitled JK Flip-Flops. If we recall, one of the basic sequential devices we've discussed thus far is the SR latch. And quite like your ex-boyfriend or your ex-girlfriend, it's got some really neat uses, but it's got an annoying habit that really kind of prevents its use in public. What is that annoying flaw for the SR latch? Namely, if I try to simultaneously set and reset this thing, the thing explodes. It doesn't work. I know you've tried it before, and it's just not an ideal circumstance. So what we're going to try to do with a JK flip-flop is not only are we going to get rid of that annoying flaw where it enters an invalid region, it's going to have another functionality which none of the other devices have thus far. And I'm going to kind of let the cat out of the bag early. It's called a toggle mode. A JK flip-flop behaves exactly like an SR latch. However, when you try to simultaneously set and reset this thing, what it does, it enters toggle mode. As the name implies, toggle, think of a toggle switch. You press it once, it switches to its opposite state. You press it again, it switches to its opposite state. And when I say opposite state, it's just opposite of what it's currently in. If it was a 0, it becomes a 1. If it was a 1, it becomes a 0, and so on and so forth. So how do you create a JK flip-flop? This is an edge trigger device. So what are we going to do? We're going to add an edge detection device. There you go. We added an edge detection device. In this case, it's a positive edge detection device. Because it's called a JK flip-flop, what am I going to do? I'm going to call it J, and I'm going to call it K. Okay, you can still think of those as set and reset. S and R if you wish. I'm going to call them J and K. Now I'm going to add a couple wires to it. Okay, I'm expanding those steering gates. Rather than 2 input NAND gates, now they are 3 input NAND gates, where Q is being fed to the bottom 3 input NAND gate, and not Q is being fed to the top steering gate. So we originally had kind of this level of feedback. Now what's happening is basically we've got feedback all the way back to the steering gates. And how does this thing work? Exactly like an SR latch, with the exception of this right there. First and foremost, when is it activated? It's activated on a positive edge. So this is only a partial truth table, because clock could be a 1, clock could be a 0, clock could be a falling edge. What happens? Well, the output for that, it's disabled. It's always in a memory state or a disabled state. So we can start thinking of all that mishmash circuitry as just a box. It's got J inputs, K input, clock input, Q output, and the inverse, not Q output if you want to use it. Like I said earlier, how does it work? Well, for the first 3 circumstances, just like an SR latch, if I am neither setting nor resetting it, what mode am I in when there's a positive clock edge? It's a memory state. If I am not setting it, because remember, J is equivalent to S, but I am resetting it because K is equivalent to R, what mode am I in? I'm in reset. Whatever Q was, it goes to a 0. Now, the third state, the third mode, when I am setting it, J1 equivalent to S, and I'm not resetting it, what mode am I in? I'm in set. So whatever Q was goes to a 1. By the way, what was the value for Q in the memory state previously? Whatever Q previously was, it's remembering it. This last one, I'm going to let the cat out of the bag. It's called toggle. What does Q do? It switches to its opposite state, whatever it was previously. If it was a 0, it becomes a 1. If it was a 1, it becomes a 0. How does it do it? Well, it does it via these feedbacks to the steering gates. Okay, to understand the toggle mode here, I made some minor modifications to the circuit. All I did was really just colored the steering gates differently. Top one's gray, bottom one's pink, and then I added the truth tables for a 3 input NAND gate, which you should know, and a 2 input NAND gate. In the circumstance where initial conditions Q is 0, not Q is 1, let's go ahead and put J1, K1 on it. What happens? Well, we should enter a toggle state, but the deal is nothing's going to happen until we get a positive edge. So that positive edge comes along. What are the inputs for the gray NAND gate and its output? What are the inputs for the pink NAND gate and its output? You should have something like this. So the gray NAND gate has 111 on its input. It has an output of 0. The pink NAND gate has inputs of 101, and its output is 1. How does an active low SR latch respond to that? Well, it's setting it. It's giving it active low 0, 2, the active low S, what happens? It sets it. How does, because there's a feedback here, how does the input to the gray and pink NAND gates change? Okay, one would think, and this is wrong, that A, B, and C inputs for the gray NAND gate is 101, and the pink NAND gate is 111, which would put this in this kind of this continually bouncing along because we'd be resetting it there. But the deal is, remember, it's positive edge detection. What happens to that positive edge? It happened. Okay, it happened and it made the change. The positive edge is gone. It's a brief moment in time. So the real input conditions for the gray and pink NAND gates are as follows. So the gray has 100, the pink has 011, and as a result of that, they both have 1 output, which is the input for the active low SR latch. It's not sending an active low, neither setting it nor resetting it. What happens now? They're in a stable condition here. I'm neither setting it nor resetting it until the next positive edge comes along. Where are we now? Well, kind of previously our erroneous state earlier. We are activated. And what's going to happen? We're going to send an active low reset signal to the active low SR latch. And we're going to be right here. And there you go. Gray is getting 101 on ABC. It's going to have a 1 output. And what is the pink going to have? It's going to have all 1s on it. What is its output going to be? It's going to be 0. And we're going to reset. What happens? Q becomes a 0, not Q becomes a 1. Positive edge goes away. And what you can do is really just kind of rewind the recording and go back to the same initial condition. What happened there in that whole time? In a toggle mode, when J is 1 and K is 1 and a positive edge occurs. Let's clean up this diagram. Q initially is a 0. What happens when that clock edge occurs? 1, 0. Clock edge goes away. Clock edge happens again. What happens to Q? 0, 1. Clock edge goes away. Clock edge comes back again. It flip-flops. It toggles. So if you're constantly sending J and K a 1, this thing will constantly be toggling every single time the clock hits. Okay, now my question to you, this is an application which we'll discuss later, what does the waveform Q look like in reference to the clock if it's constantly in toggle mode? The big question is, does the frequency speed up or slow down? How does the period affected on Q with relation to the clock? So that's a pretty neat application. Let's talk about asynchronous inputs. Okay, so I introduced the concept of asynchronous inputs in a previous lecture dealing with D flip-flops. And the same thing occurs for a JK flip-flop. You don't necessarily need to worry about how these internally, these asynchronous clear and preset inputs are wired, but if you want to, the diagram's right here. You can really just kind of start thinking about these devices in terms of a box. J is a synchronous input that's dependent upon the clock. K is a synchronous input that is dependent upon the clock. Preset and clear are asynchronous inputs. They are not dependent on the clock. Anytime I have inputs on clear or pre, I will either preset it, i.e. make Q a 1, or clear it, i.e. make Q a 0. However, if I do have clock input on J and K, the preset and the clear will override those inputs. Okay? So how does this work here? You know, why do we do these things? Is these asynchronous inputs, think about this, this is a memory device here. Let's go ahead, I've got a bunch of these things all hooked up and I want to store an 8-bit number in it. Just clear them all out prior to you storing something in there. I can do these asynchronous inputs on a number of different devices. Here's a SR latch with an active low preset and clear. Here's a D latch with an active low preset and clear. Here's a D flip-flop, which we discussed in our previous lecture, with an active low preset and clear. How do these behave? Well, just like I said there, they're asynchronous without respect to enable or clock, and they supersede those things that are synchronous. What's the bar over them mean? It means it takes a 0 to get it to do something. If there's a 0 on clear, what is the output Q? Well, regardless of D's or S's or R's or clocks or J's or K, the output for Q is 0. What if I was constantly giving clear a 0? What do you think? It's going to be constantly clear. Here's the circuit that does the presets and clears, active low, asynchronous inputs. Don't necessarily waste your time with this right here because we're just going to go straight into examples using the description of the box. And how does this thing work? When there is a positive edge. It responds to J and K inputs. What is the J and K inputs? If it's 0, 0, I'm in a memory state. If it's J0, K1, I'm resetting it. If it's J1, K0, I'm setting it. If J1, K1, I'm toggling it. And Q assumes the opposite of its prior value. However, those inputs can be superseded by those asynchronous clear and preset inputs. Let's just go straight into some examples in our next lecture.